are the major applications of digital twins, and what industries utilize this technology? To answer these questions, we are joined today by Vitor Lopes, our Digital Twin Senior Product Sales Manager at Ansys. Vitor is responsible for all digital twin business development activities in the Americas territory and has assisted customers across the various industries in their region to succeed on their twin journey. Today, he will share some of his broad use case experiences in the topic, showcasing the different ways in which twins transform business. Vitor joined Ansys after more than 10 years in the industry, bringing together different perspectives on the twin technology from roles in R&D, operations, management, and now sales. He holds a Bachelor of Science and a Master's of Science in Chemical Engineering from the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and is deemed an SME in the digital twin space. Vitor, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
Digital twins providing value across the product lifecycle, and what businesses, models, and value propositions are commonly observed?
So thank you very much, Asma, there for the introduction and the opportunity. What I can say from the broad perspective of working in all industries across the Americas is no matter which industry we get involved with, all of them are going through some level of digital transformation and adopting digital engineering practices. You will find different levels of maturity, but most have started on their journey. And it's in this space that digital twins find themselves situated, right? As Samir previously described, the most advanced stage you encounter today in the real world are the hybrid digital twins that are based on physics, right? And augmented by data, synchronized bidirectionally with the assets and adapting to each individual context as the asset is operated. Some companies are adopting these internally. So it is more of an internal business model. They may be doing it to increase yields of production, increase uptime, minimizing downtime. They may be looking at minimizing commissioning times, operational risks, costs associated. Others, they may be offering this more externally, right? So they may be building twins as a offering, in, as a service, or even as a smart product to their customers. And some are doing a little bit of both. They may be using this internally to like manufacture their own products and then finally externally to sell it to their customers, right? What we find, however, is that most digital twin projects go through stages of maturity to allow for value capturing along the asset lifecycle. And what do I mean by that? One may have a goal of getting a twin out in the field, either if it's internal or external, but connected to an asset. But they may start with as simple as a digital prototype as an initial milestone, right? So they may start where you have a model completely disconnected from the asset, yet allowing for offline optimization exercises, which provides this initial value creation before moving on to a connected environment later on and realizing the additional value propositions that I just described. If you talk specifically about OEMs, they may use these digital prototypes or even digital shadows if they're only connected partially to the asset as early as product development stages before even going through manufacturing and finally being offered to operators as a service or a product. The insights gathering doing operations are then looked back into future design cycles to improve product performance. The value proposition here is much more associated with product development metrics than it is with operational metrics. But as you can see, it's a way that you can start small and grow towards that bigger vision of getting connected digital twins adapted in the field.
So in what ways are digital twins utilized during these product stages? What are the use cases?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Like the interesting aspect about digital twins, like any good technology, is that it's very, very flexible and applicable to a variety of scenarios. So if you're talking specifically about operations or environments where you already have an asset and you're connecting it to twins, you may be using this, one of my favorites, as a virtual sensor, right? To take what you can measure, to then measure what you cannot measure as the asset is being operated. And you can take this into various different scenarios. You may use it initially for monitoring. You may use it for control. You may use it for optimization. You may then even use to predict future behavior, like, hey, when are assets going to fall performance or break so that I can service it ahead of time and minimize costs associated with unplanned downtime. Now that's the operational world, right? Now imagine you're in a scenario where you have a project design, the product has already been designed, you want to bring it to the real world, but you're still at that commissioning stage. You may use it more as an offline twin to minimize the commissioning times and risks, right? Because before the product is even built, you can start understanding, hey, how am I going to use this product in which conditions? That may happen on the field, that may happen on manufacturing lines. There's all sorts of different use cases. And finally, as early as I mentioned, as product development, you may just have a digital prototype. At that stage, you're kind of, the asset doesn't really exist. You're still designing it, but you're using the models to be able to validate designs, to optimize designs, to understand better ways to be running in different performances. It's the concept of virtual prototyping, virtual validation, deciding where to place sensors. So there's a variety of use cases across different industries, and it manifests in different ways across the product lifecycle.
So can you share some specific examples to illustrate the impact of digital twins in the various sectors?
Sure. So starting with the operation and the virtual sensors there, like most, for instance, sometimes you find a couple more of examples in some areas than others, like industries such as energy, metals and mining, industries where they have very harsh conditions, but at the same time, they need very, very tight control of operations. They may be using these twins to understand specific points in the assets or the systems, the so-called virtual sensors, where operations are happening before in a more blind way. So you don't really know what's going on. And until you actually connect the twins, you now then have the ability to start seeing, oh, our temperatures are too high here, pressures are too low, things like that. And that may drive your operational to increase yields or minimize risks or costs or, you know, performance degradation. Now, that may happen, you know, in a manufacturing setting. But for an instance, we see a lot of this happening also in the aerospace and defense, where people are actually connecting these twins to aircrafts and being able to understand when services are due, that sort of thing, a lot more refined way, because now with this concept of hybrid, you have the data there, but you also have the physics giving you an element of what is really going on, and if things are going to break, why are they breaking and where? And so you get a lot more insights, and you can service way much more planned, but you can also look back into the design and improve product development and so on and so forth, product performance in future design cycles.
So talking about hybrid digital twin, what are typical selection criteria for ideal hybrid digital twin candidates?
That's a very good question there. I'll first start maybe a little bit broader with a big digital twin project and then start narrowing down. So if you're talking about a digital twin project itself, typically you want to start with use cases that are tied to business initiatives, to key business initiatives. And one of the reasons for that is traditionally you will find the need for executive sponsorship in these type of projects. Why is that? Because as we alluded to, it's a little bit of a journey and it will involve several different teams and disciplines within the organization and sometimes even partners and external elements in the ecosystem. Moving all of these together in a unison way is not an easy task. And when you get the buy-in from the executive level and you bring those initiatives down, these projects have a tendency to move quicker and more efficiently than the ones that are brought top bottom up, just because of the nature of the multidisciplines and the types of backgrounds that you need to bring together, right? Now, if you start looking more, now going more towards the hybrid concept, right? One of the things that we say is, hey, you need to be looking for assets for which you either have models or the time to develop models fits the ROI, right? And sometimes for some operators, that was a little bit of a challenge because they may not own the physical models behind the equipment that they're operating. But with the concept of hybrid, they can take simple performance curves and data and bring them together to generate very accurate and like twins that are representative of the real world that can drive decisions, right? Now with the OEM, sometimes it's the other way around. They may have a lot of design data, but they don't have so much operational data. So no matter where you're going, where you're coming from, the hybrid concept allows you to kind of build the best model or the best twin that you can and evolve from that depending on where you're coming, whether if you have more data or if you have more design data or models associated with. I would say that the third big reason that or selection criteria that you need to be looking for is, hey, do I have the environment associated? So I may have the right projects. I may have like the people, the executive buy-in, the models, the data. But what about the environment? Are my assets connected today to sensors? Like, are they not? Like, will I have to invest in an infrastructure? Those things will dictate your level of readiness, if you will, to jump into the various stages of digital twin projects. And then we can help you. And traditionally, the industry has had a lot of guidance as far as, hey, when you are at this stage, these are the types of value propositions that you can generate before moving on to the next stage and make it more digestible. So it's not a one and all thing. It's you can actually go through stages and collect value as you evolve.
Lastly, what opportunities do you foresee the application of digital twins across industries, and how can they contribute to innovation?
That's a very good question. So one of the things that I'm seeing today is industries that are very heavy on thermal efficiency, like industries that are very dependent on burning gas or producing energy or burning some sort of energy, they also have a lot of associated metrics with sustainability, right? So one of the big initiatives that I'm seeing is customers that are looking at twins as, hey, I have today an asset. I can generate a new asset in the future to be more sustainable, but the time between starting to build the asset and actually minimizing the emissions may be long, right? So how do I start today? Oh, I have my existing assets. If I can operate them more efficiently, then I can start today already making an impact on my carbon emissions and so on and so forth, and use the value creation at that stage to even fund the development or the replacement of the fleet futurely. So this is what I'm seeing. Twins are helping bring a more immediate way of addressing the neutralization of carbon emissions goal that most companies have, right? It's a way that hey, if I look at what I have on the field, I can start making changes today. I don't have to design or change the fleet of what I have on the field to then start with this. I can start today with the assets that I own, just operating them more effectively, right? But then, as I mentioned, you also have companies that are using it in a more forward-looking vision to design the new set of products, to design the new set of assets that will operate more efficiently naturally, and then help with the carbon emission reduction in that way, right? So that's one big piece. Another thing that I will say there that is more future opportunity is there are a lot of heavily regulated industries that are going through the motions of adopting twins as a way to control and monitor operations, right? So that is manifesting itself in pharma, in nuclear, in a lot of heavy regulated industries. They're going through the motions. They went through the motions in product design to adopt, you know, the ability to use models to define performance of model on product design. Now they're doing the same thing and moving through the motions of adopting the value of models in connection to the assets in these industries to be able to operate them more efficiently as opposed or in addition to designing them more efficiently. And thirdly, one thing that I would say that is maybe more futuristic, but it's coming, is the adoption of these twins in the metaverse. So a lot of conversations as far as, hey, what if I can have a twin connected to like to the real world, but also interacting with my avatar. And now I have these virtual sensors interacting with an augmented reality environment and the metaverse. So there's a lot of different scenarios in there, right? I'm just going transitioning from what I see more immediate, you know, companies adopting it maybe more on the sustainability routes, going all the way to the metaverse.
Thank you so much, Vitor, for being part of this second episode of the Twin Talks and for sharing your invaluable insights and expertise. In the next episode, we are going to discuss hybrid digital twins and introduce the two popular approaches to building digital twins, pure data-based and physics simulation-based methods. So stay tuned for episode 3 of the Twin Talks. Thanks for watching.